Soundtrack, a continuing series devoted to the art form of film music. Scripting, resources, and production are provided by Noah Andre Trudeau. Your guide to the world of movie music is Richard Caparella.
Whenever the credits flash onto the screen, there's usually a special moment reserved for the name that follows the tag, Music By. But by this time, most of us have read our fill of the opening credits and are waiting for the film to begin. Otherwise, we've already left the theater because who wants to sit through a bunch of long credits anyway? The actors, director, producer, and writers, they get their share of the spotlight. On this program, we're going to fill in another part of that puzzle as we begin a two-part look at the name after the tag with music by Jerome Maross. Don't call Jerome Maross a film music composer. Call him instead a composer who writes film music. His involvement in movie music is not that much different from that of Aaron Copland, Virgil Thompson, or George Antheil. For each, film music was not as much an end in itself as it was just another aspect of theatrical art music. It's no coincidence that Jerome Maross has also composed with distinction for ballet and opera. Jerome Maross was born in Brooklyn, New York, in 1913. His involvement with film music came in the late 1930s, and he began his work in Hollywood on the ground level as an orchestrator. Among the composers he worked for were David Butthoff, Adolf Deutsch, Hugo Friedhofer, Frederick Hollander, Walter Scharf, and Franz Waxman. It wasn't until 1948 that Moros was able to write his own film score, a Grade B flick titled Close Up. While never completely immersed in the film music world, Moros contributed regularly to film scoring up to the mid-60s when he quit. In between lay a number of remarkable scores and a career filled with thoughts and memories. Beginning with this program and continued in the next, we're going to share as much of these thoughts and memories as we can. Taking center stage for this program is the Jerome Moros score for the 1958 Western, The Big Country. And here we have something very special. Your soundtrack producer, Noah Andre Trudeau, has been very fortunate in being able to interview Jerome Moros at some length on his film music career. After that interview, Mr. Moros generously loaned us a copy of the complete soundtrack to The Big Country. It contains several segments not commercially released on the recording for the film, segments which we're going to broadcast now with the kind permission of the composer, along with some of his comments on film scoring in general and The Big Country in particular. Jerome Moros and The Big Country.
Well, I was very excited about doing that picture. It was my first really big picture, and it was a Western, and my own style is American, unconsciously American. I just write that way. It fitted what I wrote, and without knowing it, I seem to have turned out the prototype Western. It's the one that has still become, this is the way to do a Western now, is the way I did it in Big Country. The style, the whole genre.
Thank you.
South American composers, but they all wrote that same way. The Western was the Western of the Russian steppes or the Hungarian plains. But this was a Western with American rhythms, American tunes, and a boldness and a brashness about it. And this was the way to do a Western. Chomkin would come along and do Westerns with sad Russian songs in them.
Thank you. Were you acclaimed for the score in any sort of way, or was it just another job?
No, the most peculiar, the composers and the what in Hollywood, I think they realized it was something, because I got the nomination for the Academy, but I couldn't possibly compete with the political goings on. Yeah, Chomkin won it with Old Man of the Sea.
Oh, really?
But, he really campaigned for it, had parties and all kinds of things. But it's very funny that that score has now lasted 17 years. It's still in print.
It's still fresh as today.
Yeah, you know, and it still goes on. It's lovely that it has that kind of endurance.
I can especially see why you said before how European orchestras do the concert suite from it. I can see. I mean, it's that special sort of American quality that really few composers can achieve.
Thank you.
got started in the film music business as an orchestrator, if I remember right.
Mm-hmm.
What exactly is, orchestrator, obviously orchestrates, but there's more to it than just that, isn't there?
Well, it's according to the composers you work with. Some give you a completely laid out sketch and some give you a piano piece.
Did you work with any specific composers for a length of time?
Well, yes. I worked during the war when I was at Warner Brothers. I was assigned to two composers especially. I did all of their pieces, Adolf Deutsch and Freddie Hollander. Well, Deutsch used to write everything down to the last 16th rest. And Freddie Hollander wrote Chopin-like pieces, which had to be turned into orchestral pieces. So it was a difference of style. Then, of course, we were all farmed out. I mean, if there were a rush, you'd be assigned to Steiner or anybody.
Did you work with some of the big ones, like Steiner or Cornwell?
Well, Warner Brothers had loaned Steiner over to... Selznick, and I forget what picture he was doing, and they got into some kind of problem, and I remember I had to go over and help out on some of it. I never worked with Korngold, though he was around the studio.
So, when you wrote, or perhaps even in your best of your film script, were you ever trying to somehow sneak in or make a certain musical statement either through the drama or through the music? Meaning, you're trying to pass your own message along, your own commentary on the story. Or you write.
Well, you have to. I mean, you are delineating the story musically at that point for the audience, and you've got to add to the film. You've got to heighten it or lower it or whatever the problem is there. But you're helping the film. You're helping the director. You're helping everybody. You're trying to make the best film you can. And as far as musical statements go, I never felt I was writing any differently for a film than I would write for concert or theater. Perhaps you didn't have as much time to sit and work out counterpoints or something. And you did certain things because there was a lack of time, but there was no question of writing differently for films.
Thank you.
you perhaps in a general sort of way kind of summarize how the process was and how you wrote your film music? Just take a typical creator, typical film, and then usually you came in after the film.
Yes, most of the time I came in after the film. Generally, it was in a very rough cut. And I would sit down with the producer, or sometimes with the producer and the director, and the music editor, who would make notes. And we would decide where music went. I had been schooled by Leo Forbstein at Warner Brothers, and his theory was he never knew where the brass would want music, so he'd score almost everything. My tendency is a little bit of the same way. I'll say, well, let's put music in there if I feel the scene is slightly dull. They can throw it out, you know? And after we decide what music is going to be, where the music is going to be, the music editor goes back and starts working with his moviola and ends up giving me sheets. I see the film a few times and I take the sheets and start writing.
What are the sheets?
They
indicate a length of time?
Well, they break up the scene into, completely into seconds, half-thirds of a second, every 2 seconds or something, list all the dialogue. It's a complete breakdown of the scene as as somebody doing a study of the film would break down the frames, practically.
And from there, what, you do a piano score?
Well, I write in a kind of a 4 or 5 line short sketch, short orchestral sketch. If I have time to orchestrate it myself, I can work from that. If not, it's easy on that to lay out, to mark down for the orchestrator exactly what I want him to do. And then you move to the stage and start recording. And any final changes you want to make, orchestration or cutting or anything, you make then and there.
Do you find the studio orchestras, they must be quick readers?
They're brilliant. The studio orchestras, at least in the heyday of the film period, let us say between 1935 and 1965, they were the most brilliant musicians in the country. I first arrived in Hollywood in 1936, and I was astounded at the quality of the orchestras. I wasn't working in films then, but I was working for the Chicago Opera, and I had, instead of spending the dull winter in Chicago, I had gone to Hollywood, and it was very exciting then.
Thank you.
to something taken from the film score, it tends to be shorter and more choppy. Like the Big Country album, the cuts are 2 or 3 minutes apiece, which is a good chunk of a movie. That's what surprised me, why you said it's taken away from the film score. There's no editing there, I mean, they're all...
No, but sometimes the things were edited in the film, they went in and out of them.
Right.
I believe in writing enough so that you do write a piece.
Right.
Actually, I wish they would leave those things alone, because I think the sense of form that a well-formed piece of music gives to a scene aids the scene, but it's hard to sell that idea to a director. I'm talking about what happens in opera or in musical comedy, even where, or ballet more than musical comedy, opera, ballet, where the roundness of the performance is aided by the music. Good ballets, most peculiarly, are always done to music which helped them formally.
In every case, after you scored a film and it went through all the cutting, did you see the finished product?
Yes.
Was there ever a case where they edited it against your intentions?
Yes. One. And I was horrified. The producer wasn't in town. He was producing a play on Broadway. And the director and I worked on the film, and we finished what we thought was a very good film. And the producer came back, and he cut the film to hell, and consequently had to cut the music and shift and change and all kinds of absolutely incredible things happened and destroyed a perfectly marvelous film and a perfectly wonderful score, if I may be immodest. But he destroyed the film, too, in his doing it, which was awful.
Still your name is up there.
Yeah, name is up there. The film was Five Finger Exercise, I'll tell you what it was.
It's kind of a shame, because that way when people start cursing, they'll curse you for that film, not knowing that it wasn't your fault.
Well, you've got to take your lumps.
Thank you.
Thoughts by Jerome Moross and music from his film score to The Big Country. Most of the selections you heard were from the original soundtrack made available for our use through the kind permission of the composer. The other selections, as well as additional music for the score, can be found on an imprint recording of the soundtrack on the United Artists label, LA270. Our conversation with Jerome Moross and examination of his film music concludes next week. On that program, we'll be sampling his scores to The Warlord, The Proud Rebel, and The Cardinal. We'll also talk further with Mr. Moross about those films in particular and other aspects of his film music career. I'm Richard Camparello, hoping you can join us every week at this time for more of the excitement of movie music here on Soundtrack. In the light of knowledge about the circumstances and conditions under which film composers work, we have every reason to be grateful that any good scores have been written. The film composers of the most intelligence and the most integrity often pay a price for their excellence, less fame than their more flashy colleagues, and lessening opportunity in a business that has become more and more commercial. So wrote Tony Thomas in his book, Music for the Movies. He wrote that at the beginning of a chapter titled The Price of Excellence, in which he examined the careers of Bernard Herrmann, Hugo Friedhofer, and David Raskin. I think we can safely add another name to that roster, Jerome Moross. In our program last week, we talked to Mr. Moross about film scoring in general and his film score for The Big Country. We'll begin the music portion of this program with a few selections from the 1963 Jerome Moross score to The Cardinal. The film starred Tom Tyron as a young priest whose character is formed through emotional, racial, and political stresses. The story began in the city of Rome, but also spent a good deal of time in America and Austria. So, unlike The Big Country, Moross was not able to rely on the American impulses so strong in his music. His response to the demands of the film provide a rather fascinating insight into the stylistic adaptation required of the film music composer. But before the music, let's join soundtrack producer Noah Andre Trudeau for a bit more of his conversation with film music composer Jerome Moross.
Would you agree with someone like George Antheil, who felt that a film score should also stand on its own as music?
I think most people should stand on its own. Yes, I could.
So most of you.
On the other hand, if you do a lot of films, you do get to have the, I suppose, well, I haven't done that many, but I'm sure to say, well, this film is nothing, I'm doing it for X number of dollars, so I'll just go count on it. But I think there's something anyway about the film. No matter what they are, I always try to reserve myself.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe it's bad. But it's also the feeling that perhaps I can help this film somehow.
Well, we move ahead again to The Cardinal. And at least now, if I can believe the liner notes, I believed it was an exceptional situation in which you were invited to come in on the filming.
Yeah.
How did that was that the first time you would come in that early? And how do you think it affected your music?
Well, I'd come in early when I did things like a ballet for Hans Christian Andersen. Actually, what happened was Otto... Friend was dragging me all over Europe, acting as a music department. You know, we had a lot of pre-recorded. We had at least dummy music for ballroom scenes. We had enough music
turned out he needed a lot of music going to help in the making of the picture, which ordinarily in Hollywood a music department would do. And then when you come forward, you have to adjust to it. But here I had to do it because I suppose I would figure out that would be best to keep swimming.
Well, now, in your main title, To the Cardinal, you come up with a Baroque idea there. You have the kind of motif, the echo motif. Now, that is a very obvious, that strikes me as being a very obvious medieval sound that you created in your main title, To the Cardinal.
Well, the Cardinal, much later, the Baroque sound. But all right. That purposely, the Cardinal, the main title was a walk through...
Yeah, right.
Through the Vatican, and partly through, no, not the Vatican, but the, I think they did use Bernini's peristyle in front of St. Peter's, but it was some other 16th century, 17th century castle that he was walking through, and they put those shots together. And you were entirely in a Baroque world, and I decided that musically at that point you had to throw your audience
right
into that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
selections from the Jerome Marat score to The Cardinal. That was from a deleted RCA recording, LOC 1084. We continue with selections from a Jerome Marat score that deserves more recognition than it's gotten, his music for The Proud Rebel. Again, we can see the careful line that the composer has to walk. On the one hand, The Proud Rebel was very much a Western, and Marat certainly had the capability of providing the wide-open sounds that go with most Westerns. But, on the other hand, The Proud Rebel wasn't most Westerns. It was a highly dramatic tale told in very human terms. It's the meeting of these two extremes that make the score for The Proud Rebel so special. And, in talking to Jerome Marat, one can see that he agrees.
The Proud Rebel was really a marvelous film. I really knocked my mind. So did Sam Goldin Jr. produced it. I thought it was beautiful, but he just died. So, you know, I mean, no film could have been prepared more lovingly or with more intent, acted better. It's a marvelous film. And the film died.
Right. Well, what I heard of that one album, I tended to think you were writing a little bit, it wasn't as exuberant or wide-open music as The Big Country. Right. The Big Country was the land, and what, The Proud Rebel was the people?
Yeah. Well, The Proud Rebel is more of a human drama. The Big Country is really an impersonal drama. The Big Country is writing a passive distraction in the form of the Western. He directed a passive distraction in the form of the Western.
There's a reoccurring motif in there. Did you quote a Western tune in that, or did you make that sort of waltz-like motif up?
Thank you.
selections from the Jerome Maroth score to The Proud Rebel. That was from a recording not commercially issued and which we used with the kind permission of the composer. The discography of Jerome Maroth's film scores is not as extensive as one would like. Indeed, with the next score we're going to sample, we've covered them all. The final score is titled The Warlord and was a drama set in the Dark Ages of Europe. The film's story concerned knights in armor, seagoing barbarians, and the like. It was a combination of ingredients that had a full complement of musical cliches to follow it. But as you listen to the soundtrack, I think you'll agree that, again, Maroth is able to establish a new perspective on the drama, throwing some new musical lights on an old film subject. But before the score, let's return to some closing thoughts on the art of film scoring by Jerome Maroth.
When you apply a score to the screen, how much say do you have over the volume that score is heard at in comparison to the scenes? Who determines that?
That's determined in the so-called dubbing or re-recording room after you've recorded the whole thing and the soundtrack has been made up and everything is together. And then everybody gets together in this room. It's huge for it. I'll have 28 or 30 tracks running at the same time, possibly three or four music tracks, and sound tracks, and voice tracks.
So again, that's a decision that's taken out of your hands.
To some extent, but you can go in and fight over that if you want to. But I find that that's the one point where their pragmatism really rises above everybody's ego. It has to be heard. Certain things have to have value there. And those things that have to have value are given value at the correct times. They work very hard on that. That's one point where most people really don't have to fight. Because your music could get in the way of dialogue or something. Or a soundtrack, a fabricated soundtrack. You know, sound that will get in the way of something else. They worked that out very well.
Yeah. I can imagine there must have been a sequence where maybe you did a little something that clever, and when you, by the time you see it, it's either so overwhelmed by the visuals or by the dialogue that you tell people to listen, they say, I didn't hear it.
Yeah, but you may have done something very clever and forgotten at that moment that a most important line of dialogue.
Right.
They're going to put you down.
Right.
You know, people will remember whether the line of dialogue comes out. Remember that you suddenly had an obo d'amore doing a lovely turn.
Right. Did you ever have something, though, where you were so taken with a scene that you specifically scored it to be heard a certain way and had to fight for it to be reproduced that way, either in terms of the volume or in terms of the cutting? Or again, is just a contract, once you turn over the music?
So you have no control over that. I quite often would go into the dubbing room if I was staying in Hollywood after I was doing the film. And I would go into the dubbing room and watch, and I would sometimes discuss things. But most of the time I found that they were doing very well.
Right.
They were being very fair to every element of the film. They really try to make a good film if they can. They don't want to destroy any of the things they paid for.
Right.
They're not out to undervalue the music or undervalue the dialogue or the acting. Or anything. They want at that point to make a very, very good film.
All right, let's move ahead a few years to the Warlord. All right, one thing that interested me in that film is that you didn't attempt any sort of period sounds. It was a very, it wasn't a period score. It was a setting in the 12th century, which of course sums up certain musical ideas off the bat, but you didn't follow any of those, and I'm just wondering why.
Well, it's my idea of the 12th century. I mean, I think it has an archaic sound.
Certain, yeah. Well, again, yeah, you would almost...
But it's according to whose archaism is everything else.
Right.
This is my idea of archaic. But for the...
Warlord.
The Warlord, we haven't the faintest idea what music sounded like in the 11th century. And... I just gave it an archaic sound. Just in my idea of archaic, it's like the day you see things of Greece, you know, it's not the same as Greece. We now accept that as Greece, and then you see Greece go to the gym of Hades or Black and Jump Home.
Right.
I mean, there's no way to be in Greece.
Right.
You're not talking about accepting conventions.
So you're just reacting kind of to the drama and creating your own feeling for the period. I was kind of nice, like, well, I did one program where I played Ivanhoe, Prince Valiant, and the Warlord, and compared the three. And yours was fascinating in that it was almost Valiant and Ivanhoe were almost the typical heroic larger than life scores, and yours used much the same elements. You had the brass opening, but it was a human kind of an almost wistful kind of. There was a certain quality there that just didn't have that, you know, that bold Waxman or bold Rocha.
Well, that's the way I felt that. Maybe my thinking about it was tinged by the fact that I knew the play, although the film doesn't follow the play too much, just in the broad outline. But I suppose the memory of the play is so...
I noticed several segments of the score were composed by someone else. Was that a question of time pressure?
Well, a strange thing happened on that score. They finished it on film. A fight started between the studio and on one side, and Frank, and the director, and the producer on the other side. And
Schaefer? Franklin Schaefer?
Franklin. And they, both sides began cutting it. Actually, they shouldn't have cut it at all, Schaefer. Because when the film was long, the breadth and the perfection of the movement, the slowness of the pace, created a feeling of speed. When the film was cut, it lost that and just became an ordinary film. And it lost its quality. I sat while they were fighting this out, and I had a 10-week contract, and I haven't had that much time. And after 5 weeks, finally, the film was cut down to the 2-hour film. Only 5 weeks, I think. No, it's not. It's correct. And there were these battle scenes, two big battle scenes, and I just had fallen out. Then, of course, everybody knows about it, because when it came to putting it on the record, I said, well, you must give the author credit. I refused to take credit for that.
They were going to give you credit for the battle scenes?
Oh, sure, they do on all. It's all ghostwritten. And I had a fight with Decker.
That's good. Now, the fellow who did it, he drew from your themes to create those, because it fits very well. You can notice the difference, but...
I gave him some thematic material, but most of the time it's the brass chords banging around. The drum's usual thing in battle to try to make as much sound so they're open. I don't know why they want noise in the battle.
Yeah.
You know, with all that going on, with the smashing of pikes and maces against metal and the horses' hooves, screaming and roaring, all the rest going on in a medieval battle. Why do they want more noise? But they always do.
What has been your most recent film score to date?
The last one.
You say that with a finality. I take it you're not going back.
Well, I don't have to about this. Besides, there's the film score. Film music today. And has moved into an era in which every filmmaker is hoping to get a big rock album or something out of it.
film music to aid the film is gone. The film music is now going to be a separate commercial entity on its own after the film. Well, I did three films all together. I suddenly discovered I had to buy this apartment going forward. So I made a lot of calls, and I got here to go. I did them boom, 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 one after another. Rachel, Rachel, and one in England called...
You did Rachel, Rachel?
Yes. And one in England called Guanji, the Valley of Guanji. And one in Hollywood called Hail Hero. And that, I think, is the last one. And the last one, too.
When you look back now at the film scores you've done and what work you've done, do you describe the art, the act of creating film music as a craft or as an art?
I can say this, that any composer should be a good craftsman. And unfortunately, I don't feel that the schools today are turning out craftsmen in that sense, because the composition is in a very limited frame. Composers now don't know the basic grammar, they don't know classic harmony, they don't know form. Which means that their craft has to become an inventive craft. That would not be good. But when you work in a film, you are an artist, and you have a craft. And you use both things. You write art, and you use your craft to enable you to do it in that particular form, which is the form of having 2-minute episode to say what you have to say in a 2-minute episode. And in that limited amount of time, you know, you may have 6 weeks, 5 weeks to do the film. So your craft has to be handy. But if you want to write a good score, you have to be an artist.
Thank you.
Music composed by Jerome Maross for The Warlord. That was from a deleted recording on the Decca label, DL79149. And that brings to a close this two-part look at the film music compositions of Jerome Maross. Your producer would like to thank Mr. Maross for taking the time to share his thoughts with us. Your producer would also like to thank Dorothy Burchard and Imans Kaspers for their assistance in preparation of materials. I'm Richard Caparilla, reminding you that we look into new and different aspects of movie music every week at this time here on Soundtrack.